Hi, I am Dr. Sharjeel, and today this 60 years old male presented with gradual onset of bilateral drooping of the upper eyelids for the last 5 years. There was no history of double vision, diplopia, no history of trauma, surgery, and any known systemic illness. There was no history of fatigability. And according to the patient, the ptosis was same at morning and in the evenings. The only significant point in the history was dry mouth and difficulty swallowing solid foods. I shook hand with him to note the release of the grip. It was normal. There was no frontal baldness and facial expressions were there. On fundus examination, normal fundus, no pigmentary retinopathy. So myotonic dystrophy was also ruled out. After history and handshake, I started ptosis examination. So, in ptosis examination, I follow the rule of 5 structures to observe, 5 things to measure, and then the other measurements. So, the 5 structures to observe, you have to observe the face for dysmorphic features, trauma scars, asymmetry, facial palsy. Then you have to observe the brow. Like in this patient, there is abnormally high position of the brow due to frontalis overaction. In facial palsy, you will be having low brow position than normal. Then you have to check after face and brow, you have to check the globes. Any associated squint, proptosis, enophthalmos, ptosis bulbi, that can lead to pseudoptosis as well. Then lids for the trauma, surgical scar marks, and pupils for anisocoria, which can be seen in Horner, in third nerve, pupil involving palsy, and also heterochromia in Horner syndrome. After observing these things, you have to measure. You have to measure 5 things, 3 in the primary position and 2 in the down position. In the primary position, you have to measure palpebral fissure height, like we have done, distance between the upper and lower lid margin in primary gaze. In our patient, it was 5 millimeter. Then you have to measure marginal reflex distance in the primary gaze, and in our patient, you have to tell the patient to look in the primary gaze, and then with a pen torch you should see the corneal reflex and the distance between the corneal reflex and the upper eyelid margin. Now here in severe ptosis, you will not be able to see the corneal reflex, so here the marginal reflex distance was -2 millimeter, because when the ptosis is up to the center of the cornea, the marginal reflex distance is 0, and below the center of the cornea, if 1 millimeter, it is -1, and -2 if the lids droop 2 millimeter below the center of the cornea. So in our patient, -2 in both eyes. The third measurement in primary position is pre-tarsal show, the distance between the upper lid margin and the upper lid crease. Now interestingly, in our patient, the upper lid crease was absent, so we were unable to measure the pre-tarsal show. Then in the down gaze, we measured the levator function. When you measure levator function, you should press the brow to negate the assisting action of frontalis, because frontalis assist in elevating the upper lid. So here in our case, it was 5 millimeter, which is considered poor in both eyes. The other thing to measure in down gaze is upper lid crease. Now I have already told that it was absent, but normally upper lid crease is 8 to 10 millimeter and levator function is 13 to 16 millimeters. After measurements, then you should check the other things. You should do motility, extraocular movements. Like in our, there was symmetric decrease of both eyes markedly in up gaze and left gaze, whereas in right gaze and down gaze there was some movement. So symmetric decrease of extraocular movements is present in chronic progressive external ophthalmoplegia, CPEO, but CPEO occur in teenage, whereas our patient was elder. And symmetric decrease of movements also occur in myotonic dystrophy, but we have already ruled out because there was no frontal baldness, no pigmentary retinopathy, and no expressionless face. In third nerve palsy, you should also see extraocular movement. The eye is down and out with residual abduction and torsional movement due to fourth nerve. So if you see a CPEO like picture with swallowing difficulty, like here in this case, so clinically we diagnosed him as a case of oculopharyngeal dystrophy. In Karen-Sayre syndrome, you can have pigmentary retinopathy, and then you should also do echocardiography for her defects. You should also check refractive errors and visual acuity. The other things which you should do in a ptosis patient, you should do, check the Bell's phenomena. Like in our patient, the Bell's phenomena was poor. So when you have got a poor Bell's phenomena, it means that you are unable to elevate the lids surgically too much because exposure keratopathy will occur. So minimal sling, we have got one option in oculopharyngeal dystrophy, and lid crutches is the another option. So for myasthenia gravis, you can do, you can check fatigability, you can also check cognitive sign, and you can check jaw winking for a congenital type of a congenital ptosis. So these are the tests which you should also perform. And so we diagnosed this case as a case of oculopharyngeal dystrophy, a variant of progressive external ophthalmoplegia. We also did creatine phosphate kinase. The normal values are 50 to 170 units per liter, and in our case it was 900 units per liter, which are too much high, and which shows that there is a pathology of the skeletal muscles. So that confirms the diagnosis of oculopharyngeal dystrophy. So for our patient, the first choice was eyelid crutches. We gave the order of eyelid crutches, and when they will arrive, we hope that his problem will be solved and we should not proceed for minimal sling. Thank you.